One thing that's easy to observe right away is that the outcomes, though, are often highly discontinuous, unexpected, and non-linear. A really recent statement of that point that I thought was extremely persuasive and dramatic was from Ed Ayer in his recent book, In the Presence of My Enemies, in the beginning of the Civil War, where Ed basically uses a bottom-up methodological perspective, using a lot of the techniques of social history in order to talk about the experience of a turning point of climactic change. And one of the observations Ed has, for example, is, I'm quoting now, the Civil War did not approach the border like a slowly building storm. It came like an earthquake, with uneven and unpredictable periods of quiet between abrupt seismic shifts that shook the entire landscape. It came by sudden realignments, its tremors giving no indication of the scale of the violence that would soon follow. People changed their minds overnight, reversing what they had said and done for years. Later in the book, Ed goes on to make an argument saying that the metaphor he found most arresting to explain this theory of change, the macro model that he posits, he borrows from Stephen Jay Gould in his writings on natural history, especially a book called Wonderful Luck. And Gould had made an argument that has there's a large discussion about in his world, about a theory called punctuated equilibrium. There's a steady state equilibrium, then there's a punctuation in which there's an abrupt nonlinear shift. All right. Let's play for a moment with that macro model that Ed posits, I think, quite wisely. For example, if you go to Gould and look a little more closely at what Gould has to say, which I've done for other reasons some years earlier, here's what Gould says. He says, invariant laws of nature impact the general forms and functions of organisms. They set the channels in which organic design must evolve. But the channels are so broad relative to the details that fascinate us. The physical channels do not specify arthropods, annelids, mollusks, invertebrates, but at most, bilaterally symmetrical organisms based on repeated functions. The boundaries of the channels, Gould continues, retreat even further into the distance when we ask the essential questions about our own origin. When we set our focus upon the level of detail that regulates most common questions about the history of life, contingency dominates, and the predictability of general form recedes to an irrelevant fact. Now, maybe that's an overstatement. What that means to me, then, is that you start with a macro model of change because the pre-existing circumstances remain highly important. So this is not an ideological war in which I say, that's unimportant. I want to privilege this over that. You don't have to, it's not a zero-sum game. But it does mean that your macro model logically needs a companion micro model. Because you need the macro model for the overarching systemic occurrences, and then you need a micro model for this catalytic event in its interior. Because then, if you've been deeply, Gould has to have some model for what's been happening in that punctuation moment. Now, the interesting thing about history, though, of course, is that history isn't driven by laws of natural physics. Especially in some of the areas that I tend to dwell on, these are very human choices. I just leave the point then. You need a companion micromodel. This is a companion micromodel of intense study of some moment of contingent public choice, framed and disciplined by counterfactual analyses that can help you identify those moments with greater precision. And that leads me to my second observation, which is that I think the quality of the study of these moments in general is actually not terrific. It's highly variable, which is not surprising because there's actually no rigorous toolkit or set of methods that you would use in instructing your students on here's how you study turning points in political history. of course, you would go back, well, you need to write a narrative that's enriched by all the study and the use of sources, and all that would be true. But there's not a systematic methodology that is easy to impart, that you can look in a historiographical textbook and say, yes, here's how you do this. And so the quality is variable. And often what I find is that historians, even historians who appear to be studying an event very closely, are usually at about 10,000 feet, in my view, instead of 30,000 feet. But they're not flying over it, they're doing U-2 level reconnaissance photographs. Or maybe jet overflights at a lower level, but they're not helicopters hovering at 100 feet, much less being on the ground in the room. Tell you the truth, I mean, my general assessment of this is that our understanding of these turning points from a methodological perspective is comparable to about the understanding of the causes of disease among the greatest experts in the world of 1850, before the widespread use of microscopes and the discovery of microorganisms and their etiology. Now, how do I come to that conclusion? And I, by the way, I can single out exceptions where I think that are really remarkable, some of them written by people here. But I don't think the exceptions invalidate the general statement. I come to that discovery through just personal experiences of several kinds. The first of these was when I came out of government after the intense period of diplomacy surrounding the end of the Cold War and began teaching at Harvard. And there was this immediate outpouring of literature, especially from the international relations theory community, whose work I followed. I followed more back then. About, the causes and consequences of the Cold War, why did the Cold War end? And that literature was so wholly unsatisfactory and was so almost unreal in comparison to my understanding of what had happened, that it really gave me a lot of second thought. I wrote a book about that period that was trying to capture a piece of it. But there was a very strong sense that of disillusionment, the people who are studying these matters, they really do not understand what's going on in these inside the engine, which usually may not be of terribly great importance, but sometimes it is. A second experience I had that was also very powerful, maybe even more powerful, was my experience when I began working on the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Kennedy tapes. Now, one could do a whole talk about the historiographical significance of the discovery and effective use of these reports. Because if you think about, reflect on this, as a form of historical evidence, these recordings are an astonishing thing. And imagine if, if we had recordings of Lincoln's deliberations in the Sumter process. We actually had the recordings of the meeting. What an utter sensation that would be. But beyond the knowledge of the particular event, think about this from a methodological perspective. For the first time, the historian actually can be in the room during the meetings. So I don't have to speculate as much, at least on something. So I can, I've listened to John Kennedy. I've over and over listened to Kennedy explain certain things about this to me. Because I've been fly on the wall. I've probably sat in on more of John Kennedy's White House meetings than all but a handful of his inner circle of White House aides. This is an amazing thing. And one of the amazing things about this for the missile crisis is here's an episode that people had worked on really hard for decades. And they thought they pretty well had it by around the mid-1980s, late 1980s, when there was a big outpouring of work on this.